Hello everybody, this is Pixtour from Tool.io, and I've spent way too much time working on the upcoming new version of Tool.io, and I felt the urge to scratch my itch to do a little bit of patching. So once in a while you may not only work on something, but you will actually use it, eating your own dog food and stuff. So while I'm a little bit too lazy to make proper tool tutorials, although that would be the right thing to do. But to fill the time in between, I decided to make some copycat videos. Which means I will look at an animation I like and I will try to rebuild that in tool. So, and I scrambled on this video here in the background, which I think looks super cool. I stumbled on this, let me see, where is my browser here? So I stumbled over this on Reddit, where this guy asked, like, how would you do this in Cinema 4D? Obviously, we are not really using Cinema 4D, but tool. Somewhere in the replies, somebody pointed out this profile here, VM, by GTD Martile. I'm not sure if this is a correct pronunciation. As you might hear, I am not really good with languages. But anyways, obviously, like, these screenshots look gorgeous and they're way higher resolution than the stuff we have. But I will focus on this animation here and I will try that to build it in Tool. And if you are wondering what is this all about, so Tool, an open source software, supposedly now even runs with emulation on the Mac. It's free, easy to use, or kind of easy to use, but supposedly it's really nice. Maybe I will bring down the background music here a little bit. So let me know what you think about like having music in the background. I kind of like it, but yeah, maybe it's, let's see how this goes. So anyways, I loaded this one here with Play Video, downloaded MP4 from the internets. And so let's pause this here and study this a little bit. So maybe I have shift escape here to scrub a little bit through the timeline. And I already spent some time looking at this, and besides the super gorgeous color and the very nice transitions here between the colors, obviously it has a bunch of like this motion design overlays, so maybe we'll find some time to build these. But the interesting thing are these ribbon structures here, which I think is super neat. So really, I really like that. And so the interesting thing is that sometimes they are black and sometimes they are lit up and contributing to this overarching glow here. Yeah, so I have no clue how you would build this in Cinema. We would try to do this more or less with 2D effects. It's a nice exercise. So let's see how this is going. So let's bring on the music even more. I think it's way too loud. Okay, so let's start by using a operator called compare images. And I like this one a lot because it gives us, it slices through the image here and shows us a nice distribution of these colors. And there's a second input here. And if we load anything, then we can actually compare two images. And it's, it's just kind of interesting. So we don't need to intensity, and obviously we don't need the toad, the default image here. We want to start from scratch, so let's render something. Let's pin this. I set the aspect ratio here to 1:1, so make it square. And to compare images, I think it's a little bit easier to see. Maybe if you change this rotation here to 45 degrees, roughly. So then, it's kind of interesting that it's already interesting that, I thought it would be like the rotation would be 45, but it's more like 40. Yeah, I think this is like there's a lot of subtle design choices that went into there, which is super nice. So maybe not only maybe, I'm pretty sure I'm also learning a lot about design here. So let's start by building these ribbon structures. And I think what we can see is, if we jumped back to the original, that it's a bunch of lines here. Maybe 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, and so on. So maybe 12 or so over across. And then these ribbons are somewhat being stretched or squeezed together, for whatever you would call this. Maybe it's almost like they are squeezed apart here. So let's try to build something like this. So we can start by creating linear points, and then we repeat at these points other linear points. And maybe if we look at how this pressing P here, so right now this doesn't really amount to anything. It's like points on points, doesn't really make much sense. I think this music is still too loud for me. I think I have to squeeze this down a little bit. Oh yeah, this is full volume here. I'm sorry about that. So let's tweak this down a little bit, and we can tweak it up here. OBS. Okay. Are you hearing me? The music. It's like a clap. So, anyways. So currently nothing happened because we repeated a bunch of points, like lines, on top of each other. So like this is one line with a lot of lines on top of each other. So this doesn't really make sense. But if we change the orientation axis, you see, okay, actually, it somewhat makes sense. So if we change this to Y, and we change the count to, let's say, 12 here, then we see, okay, this might approach something. We can also use the Bayesian gain here and squeeze this so we can have like a little bit of in more interesting contribution. And I think we probably want to leave the central thing free. Then maybe we enter this, make this like square, and no, maybe we make this straight and squeeze this a little bit so we have it a little bit precise. Well, maybe something like this. Then we can use the length factor here. So remember, like there's a line, imagine line here, and this is the line that is being replicated. So if we change the line here, we can actually extend these. Currently, it has 100 points. Let's see if this resolution-wise is good enough, or if we have to squeeze this up a little bit. And then we want to have this squeeze thing here. So I think the easiest way to do this is probably to have a selection. First, we have a transform point, and we can say, okay, let's squeeze these together, like squeeze them. And then we select some points. So the squeezing doesn't have, only happens within this volume here. So we can go into the draw lines and say, don't use the width, don't use the selection for width. And so now we can actually experiment with how much do we want to stretch these or squeeze them. Let's squeeze them. And then we can fine-tune these things later. And so the select points operator has once again a bias. And I think we should be able to maybe interpolate this a little bit more softly so we don't have this stretching thing there. I think maybe like a little bit of this, maybe like this. And I think I still don't like these guys. So maybe we can To be honest, I'm not really sure. Like, maybe we can smooth this out later with a resampling. But yeah, let's go into. Let's start with this. So now, currently, the select points is a. We see that if we move this here, this is like a spherical selection, which is like a little bit of. It's a little bit awkward for what we need. And we have the volume shape here for this operator, and we can change this to plane. And then we can rotate the plane here. So maybe we rotate this by minus 90 degrees. And then we can move it back into the center. And then the falloff here is like the width of the scaling. Then we can take out all of this. Maybe put this into a group. And then we put this into our render target. And if we select the render target, we see, ah, okay, we have something here. And if we put this into our compare images, we see, well, a long way to go, but it's a start. So let's rotate this guy here a little bit. So the 41 degrees. Obviously, our points have to be longer. I think the select points here should be a little bit further toward this guy here. And what we also see is that, so these are not really points, or not like, this is not lines. And they seem to have some kind of direction, like a gradient being on this, almost like a ribbon structure with some depth. And there actually is an operator called draw ribbons. It's a little bit peculiar, but it does the job. So let's draw this in. And we already see that it's like something really weird is going on. And I think this has to do with the orientation of the points, how we created them with the line points here. And so I think if we twist them just right, so by 90 degrees, we will have something that resembles more like the ribbon structure we expect. Maybe I will bring this up a little bit. So then we want to have like a little bit of gradient on this. So maybe we bring this over, we set a material. And in the material, we set the base color here, and we set the base. Maybe we should set the base color to, yeah, to a gradient here. Let's take the gradient, and let's rotate this by 90 degrees. And actually, this looks already better. I think it's. I'm actually surprised. So. Maybe we drag this down to the remove this. We click once to add a new step here, and then we change the opacity. And so one thing we have to later think about, like this step looks a little bit awkward, but one step after the other. So the next thing is, we want to have like a little bit of variation across these lines and these lines. And we can do this by using the spread point attributes. And there is a little bit of discussion going on about this name of this operator, which is probably going to change. What it does is it takes like all the points in a buffer and spreads attributes across it. And one attribute, for instance, is the color. So if we say, let's say we have a darker color, and let's say we have this, let's close this, maybe we have the darker color in the outside and the inner color in the inside, then we see a little bit how this works. You know, it's like a gradient, and the gradient is being spread across these points. And maybe we have like, maybe make it like so. We can do the same thing with this other op here. So let's press Ctrl D to duplicate this up, drag it in there, and here the spread point parameter has like a really nice thing which is called mapping modes, and there's a repeat option here, and with this we can actually repeat this gradient. So we could say the range is a little bit smaller, so we have like, you know, like this pattern structure, and we can scroll through this, and I think we can now balance a little bit like how to get like this darkness in there. So let's see, this one was so dark is good. Make a black dark and black dark. And let's just animate this face by clicking once and attaching this to time, pressing space to select the preset, and we tick slow 16. And then we can enable background motion, and we already see like a little bit of animation there. I mean, obviously we can, yeah, we want to do stuff in real time. Maybe this is a little bit too slow. Maybe like a little bit faster. So this is going now endless. I think in the original animation, let's go here, like, I think here it's more like a, it's not really a wave. It's more like a, interesting, yeah. I'm not really sure like how this pattern is moving there. I to be frank, I like somewhat that is going into one direction only. So let's stick with this. But obviously instead of time, we could do something like an in value here. Stick this into the face. And then if you would change the shape to something, let's say like a sine or something, so we could have the same thing, and then we could slow this down. But yeah, so let's get rid of this. I like the linear animation. So face again, stick it in there. So now, so this looks still super crappy. So let's start with some post-processing. And I guess most of the things we are going to do in this tutorial will be post-processing. So, we do the post-processing on this thing here. We don't need the frog anymore. And let's see. Maybe we don't have to look at this much. That much. So let's consider all the nice things we can insert between the render target and the final result. So, so to start with, we need glow, tons of good. But the interesting thing here is that there's also like this super big blurring at the edges. And I want to actually start with this. And there's an operator called blur with mask. Every time you see this little dot here, this means that it requires an input, so we click on this input, and then we can use linear gradient again. So this is our mask. If we crank up the blur with mask like crazy, we see that it's destroying our image. But if we take the linear gradient here and we flip this, maybe to the, what did we say, 41 degrees, which would probably be 41 degrees plus 90 degrees. And then we might want to have ping pong here. And maybe we leave some spacing in the middle. Ah, look at that, it already looks interesting. So let's move this. Oh, yeah, if we look at this, if we move this back and forth, it already looks a little bit more interesting. So I think this is a good moment to talk a little bit about gradients and gradient interpolations. I always make this segue and the detour, but I think you can't learn enough about color interpolations. So quick detour here, linear gradient. We look at this thing here. And if we add an operator called image levels, then we see that by default linear gradient is linear interpolated. And I think like this is what nerds want. You know, they don't want any uncertainty, but this is not what designers want. Designers want, for instance, the smooth interpolation, which looks way better. And actually, let's try that. Let's switch this interpolation. Go back to our mode here, and we see a little bit how the blurring starts here like crazy. And I think the music is still a little bit too loud. I hope we don't have to redo this tutorial. But anyways. We see how rapidly like the blurring starts here. And if we change the interpolation to smooth, I think this is a much more gradient increase into the blurred ranges. Okay, obviously we also need some kind of glow, more glow. How glow can you go? So we select this here, press tab and insert a glow operator. Being suggested. Let's crank up the intensity a little bit and the radius a little bit. And now, it's like obviously this doesn't really glow, and doesn't glow because we are not really HDR yet. So let's get rid of this. And what does HDR mean? So if we look once again, we can use the image levels operator, which is kind of nice because it shows a little bit the average brightness of what we are seeing here. So currently this is, it looks a little bit, it looks brighter than it is, but it's still like 20% or so of the brightness. But we can go into the draw ribbons, click the color and then hold control. And it's a little bit, yeah, you need to know that it's a little bit hidden. But if you hold control, then you can actually crank the brightness up. And you can actually crank it up above one, which is completely fine because we're HDR. And cranking this up is great for the glow operator. Because the glow operator will actually distribute this brightness and, you know, like distribute it over like the complete image. And if we change here the radius, then we see how this leads to a very nice, interesting glow. I think, so what I see here is like that we have like a short passage there that's dark, but it's not big enough. So let's go back here to the spread point attributes. And once again, take the interpolation and change it also to smooth. Look at this, it looks much better. And then maybe we can actually let's make it a little bit directional. So like, you know, like it's more like not symmetrical, but there's a sharp edge and a softer edge at the other side. I think I like this. And maybe maybe this was a little bit too much, but so let's crank it in where we have a nice meet, but it's been some glow going on, but not too much. Also, let's look back at our reference image. We have this guy here. And there seems to be some kind of like it's moving back and forth here. Let's see how we can do this. So we take let's take a layer 2D and then stick it into our group. And obviously it's way too large. So if we scale this down, so here we go. And it's already glowing a little bit. Obviously we can make this glow much more. And so it has this sharp corners there. So maybe we use a rounded rect. And we can crank up the feathering a little bit and make this rect, maybe make it a little bit like, what would you say is, like change the aspect ratio to adjust a little bit more to the shape we need. And then I think we need to stretch a little bit. So, okay. And so, I think this looks interesting. So one thing, actually, there it already looks nice. So if it's getting dark, it actually looks already interesting. I think it might be a little bit too bright. Let's see if we find a sweet spot here. It's between too dark and too bright. Okay, so maybe we just the size a little bit. And then, I know sooner or later we have to talk about colors, but let's stick for brightness, to the brightness right now. And also, like, in this animation, in the original animation, this moves back and forth. So let's do the same thing. So we take the position here. This is the position. We click once, and then we use animate vec 2. So right now this is cyclic. Looks a little bit confusing that it's like it's like so confusing that it's moving up. But I think this is because if we rotate it back, so we see that it's actually moving in a diagonal. And this means if we change the amplitude here and say it's only moving in Z. Oh, wait a second, it's only moving in Z, in X. Then the direction looks nicer, and then we can change the shape to sine. And then let's slow this down a little bit. Okay, so now it's moving slowly and gradually. And another thing we might want to do is, so I mean, we have like this animation here. And currently it's sine, which means it's sined with a G going into negative. But we could use the same speed here, change this to wave. And then we could later, if we decide to do so, use sample gradient. Oh, wait a second. This is a vec2. In the value wave, so with not with a vec2 but with a normal anim, we can then use a sample gradient, and then we could actually stack this into the color and say on the inter, obviously, like we need to have the same frequency here. I know we could say, okay, every time it's at the corners, it's dark. Every time it's in the middle, it's bright. And let's keep this as an option for later. It might be a good idea to tweak stuff. We can do this later if we desire. So for now, let's leave this out. Get rid of this guy here. Okay, now let's talk a little bit about color. One thing that works pretty well for me is the remap color operator. And you already guessed what remap color does. It takes a gradient and takes an input image and then remaps the color. And it's a great operator because it's just very versatile. So it takes the individual channels and then maps black to the left side of the gradients and white to the right side of the gradients. It will clamp at one. So this doesn't go well with HDR images, but Afterglow, I think it's just fine. And the cool thing is we can click this here and then we can hold Alt, hover over the original image, and then pick this color here. And we can take the white edge here and then pick this color here. Wait a second, this looks crappy. Okay, maybe we add a new image there, input there, and once again get like a little bit wet. And maybe we find some way where it looks okay-ish. The color distribution. Maybe like a little bit more red here. And maybe we can add a little bit more glow after this. Oh, I don't like this. Let's leave it like this. I think we should also it's okay, it's definitely time to tweak the glow settings here a little bit. So like maybe increase the radius a little bit further. And maybe we take this guy here. Blur it a little bit. And maybe we can also take the ribbons. Get a little bit wider here. And I think somehow like this guy, like I think this is like a little bit ugly. This definitely needs some tweaking. So I think what we should do is after the transformation of these points, so maybe we smooth these points. And I think there is like there should be a resample point. Let's see if this works. Resample. Sample points. Sample. I think this is this guy here. Yeah, and it wants a number of points, so how many points should we get? And oh no. I mean, it makes it smoother. Yeah, it definitely. So I think it it doesn't work well with like multiple points or multiple disconnected lines, which is kind of a bummer, I have to say. Ooh, oh, it's a shame. So okay, let's take this guy back again. And yeah, just stick with this. Boom. Okay, we don't need the gizmo there for now. I have to say, I'm not really happy with this thing here. And I think we could also add something else here. There is I think there should be something like glow. Yeah, so many. Let's take like, let's try this guy, chromatic. So we can also obviously use the presets here to see if they if we find something that looks interesting. So maybe we increase the size here a little bit. A bit of distortion. And yeah, I think I'm, to be honest, I'm not really sure about like this remap color thing. I think it, like looking at this guy, I like it way more. And also what I see is that like this edge, this outer edge gets lost quite a bit here. So let's work a little bit on this guy here. So let's go in here and so like if this is the texture here. Look in here, yeah, we can see that this is the texture across the space. So let's try to maybe pin this first. And I think one of the nice interpolation modes is this spline operator, which works a little bit more like a gradient curve. So we can really try to emphasize this outer edge here. Also, I think the dark needs to be much longer. So let's emphasize the dark here. And let's make sure that the ribbons are always written independent of the Z-test. So let's disable this. Okay. Let's see the blur pass actually. I mean, this looks pretty kind of nifty here. And maybe one way to introduce a little bit more variation is by actually moving this back and forth. Oh, look at this. This looks really nice. So let's maybe we just add a little bit of also let's use anim value. Let's use anim value. And then once again, we use sign. We make this a little bit slower. And maybe we actually we use like an arbitrary value here, so that there is like not really like a repetition going on. And obviously this amplitude is way too much. Let's crank this down a little bit. So we have like a little bit of variation. We see how this node moves slowly back and forth. Okay. So let's check the glow again. I wonder if the order of the glow and the blur with mask makes actually a difference. So let's put this in here and glow this there. And actually, I think it looks kind of more interesting. I think the chromatic aberration, so I'm not really sure if we actually need this. And it leads to... It's a little bit sad because it's it twists into both sides, which is kind of it sharpens it distracts a little bit from like the it takes a little bit away from the sharp edge here, and I think I don't like this, so let's keep this out for now. And then let's look a little about the remap colors. Like if we look at the color distribution here, I think this looks like it really loses a lot of depth here. And I think for bringing down the lows for this background color is nice. So we should leave this for a later step. But let's only do this. So we hold Alt again and bring back the colors here. And in the top, there were light color lights. We use just a traditional color grade. And then with color grade, we can pick the gain, which is the highlight color here. And then let's try to crank this up a little bit and see if we can actually get something there. And then let's do this color grade first. Let's actually do something. Looks kind of interesting. Okay. We can still like push the lights a little bit into the reds. I think it's like getting like this color distribution is like very interesting, very challenging. Bypass this guy here. We can also try to only use color grade. I have made mixed experience with this. So if we bring up the original color here, and then we lift the darks, maybe pick the original color once again. So we do have the same tonality. Bring it up. Maybe the U should be okay, but the situation is like maybe we bring this down. Yeah, okay. And then if we crank up the brightness here quite a bit and make this reddish. Yeah, this is really interesting color grading thing. I'm not happy with this. I'm really not happy. But okay. I'm sorry about this. So maybe let's not get lost too much into this. And maybe we can crank up the glow a little bit more. And maybe crank down this a little bit. Well, it's okayish, I guess. It's okayish. Let's leave it with this. So maybe I'm sorry for getting too much distracted here. So let's finish up by like adding like this touches here in the background. So we have like this little dot grids, and let's try these. So so we want to apply these after all our color corrections, because if I wouldn't do this, grid points, draw points, like then it would look just weird, you know, because suddenly I have to start with, I have this rotation in there. Okay, obviously I could rotate this back. We could transform points and use the negative 41 rotation here. And actually, now that I'm looking at this, maybe it's actually an interesting idea. But yeah, it still looks kind of it looks a little bit strange that it's like being blurred and stuff. Also, I mean, like maybe not. Oh, I'm so confused. Maybe it looks nice. Maybe so if you squeeze this down a little bit. So actually, maybe I will leave this because it looks interesting. It adds a little bit of detail. What happens if I make this a little bit? Yeah, maybe I will leave this in there because I somewhat like it. But to have something after the post-processing, we need to have another layer and another composition thing here. So after all this, we render this into a layer. And we have a group here. Put this into our group. We can take the draw points we had earlier and drag them in here. And then we render once again our group. And then we drag this into our final composition. And obviously, we don't need these guys here. Hey, what happened to the music? Let's put some music on. So then, obviously, here we can pick the points. I think they are a little bit, it looks like they are a little bit bluish here. So let's pick the color here. And render them, drop points. Oh no, I picked the wrong color. Pick. So. Interesting, it's getting so dark. Ah, so we are rendering these points precisely on the blurred other points in the background. So, which brings for an interesting effect, but maybe we squeeze them up a little bit and increase their size. And maybe we, these draw points, they have a texture attribute, so we can actually use let's take a render target. Let's make this white. Let's say, okay, let's make it like a very small resolution and let's plug it in there. So now these are square. And maybe change the size a little bit. And then we can randomize these points a little bit. Randomize points. And maybe change the size a little bit. So, and maybe also, can we change the stretch here as well? No, good enough. Then some of these points are not even visible. And I think we can do this by filtering some out. So filter points. So right now we are only filtering one, but let's again. Bring this down. Here is our grid. Here are our points. And so if we say, let's say, what is this like? 6x6 maybe. 6x6. Increase the size a little bit. Maybe make it 5x5. Increase the size a little bit. and then we can scatter which points to select. So like a bunch of them. Scatter this and then see maybe if we get a nice result here. And maybe also make these guys a little bit wider. So, okay. Blend mode is normal. So, I'm kind of irritated that it looks, maybe we changed the resolution here a little bit. So, wait a second, it takes the original, when comparing the image, it takes the original resolution and forces this resolution of this video to our render target here, which makes everything super blurry. So let's switch these two. And now if we force this into one by one, we get the original resolution we have here. And should be a bit sharper. So, I'm still irritating why this doesn't look points. Ah, here, there we go. So, and here, draw points. Okay, bring this down a little bit. Maybe like make it a little bit more transparent. And then we have like these raster lines here, which it also looks kind of interesting. So we are the same thing. Let's take some, let's take a random string. So this should give us some random colors. And I think there is a scramble buffer or something. With random string, maybe draw this to a text. Plug it in there. Okay, we have some weird stuff here. Let's bring this down to a small size here. Maybe make it left align. Left. Random. I think there is a word wrap. If we bring this down a little bit. And maybe change the and maybe we have like the rate here and constantly have something. Okay, bring down the font size even more. Okay, and then we can just take the text here and place it somewhere. Let's have one here. And let's have another one somewhere else to the left. And then I think they also had like a bunch of smaller text that were rotated. Once again, we transform points. We use the rotation of the 41 degree here. Yeah, I think it was somewhere here or there. I can't even remember. And maybe we also have like one or two this 90 degrees. I think I wonder if it's possible if you just plug this in here and then maybe can replace, search and replace the line break with something else. And maybe we change like the mark shank of the buffer to something shorter. Okay, I don't know. Okay, that's definitely not what the original was, but let's compare these two. So if we don't split, but if we actually blend two images and we take the original video and we plug it in there and then we bring down the alpha, we can actually check the resolution here. So one thing is that it's like all like a little bit orangey. And the easiest thing I found to have like these guys all have the same color, we can select them all, put them into a group, and then we just unplug them here. And we then use our group. And then we can use the group here and recolorize them. So this guy. A bit more here. And I wonder if we can actually make this a little bit more transparent than the others. So. Oh. Well. Okay, well, I don't know. I think I'm getting a little bit distracted here. But yeah, it was definitely a good exercise. I mean, now, like, if looking at the result, I think it's okay-ish. I have to say, I'm still not really happy with like the color transition here. I think this could be way better. So probably somewhere with the glow and the glow distribution and the intensity here, so they there needs to be some tweaking going on. But yeah, the nice thing is that's all real time. Yeah, this is the cool thing. So we can actually go in here and find all kinds of weird ways how to do like this things. And yeah, as you imagine, it's like so nice to work procedurally into doing like all these kinds of little things here. So yeah, just like going through the presets. Yeah, it's a lot of fun. Okay, yeah, thanks for watching. Yeah, let me know what you think in the comments. I probably will build more. If you have any proposals of what to build else differently, what else to copy, let me know. And I'm looking forward to show some new features with the next version of Tool. Thanks for watching. Bye.